Okay, so what is a fingerprint? You've heard the term fingerprint your whole life, probably. We all have fingerprints, but if someone asked you, could you actually define it? So a fingerprint is just an outline or the impression of the friction ridges on the palmar surface of the fingers. The fingerprint goes down to, obviously, the first joint of the finger, or if someone just asks you what a print is or a known print, then you can discuss that a little bit further. So there are three basic pattern types: arches, loops, and whorls. The arches only occur in about 5% of the population. I always like to ask who has arches. Do you guys know what your pattern types are? Have you ever looked? I always ask about arches because I have a lot of arches and they're rare, so I always like to see who else has them because it's interesting to me. Loops are the most commonly occurring. They're about 60 to 65% of the population, and whorls occur in about 30 to 35% of the population. Just some general knowledge for you guys to have. Has anyone worked with police stations, any law enforcement before where you've taken fingerprints of individuals? Anyone? One person? Yes? Okay. Okay. So I don't know how familiar you are with actually comparing fingerprints. You may have heard some things like point counting, or you may have watched CSI where they show that their IAFA system or version of it comes up and kind of scans across the screen and makes some magic and the prints pop up and it says match. It doesn't work like that. In order for us to do a comparison of fingerprints, palm prints, or footprints, we compare them all the same way. We use something known as a scientific methodology known as ACE-V. It's analysis, comparison, evaluation, and verification. And we look at all the information within that fingerprint in order to make our identification or exclusion decision. So the first thing that we're going to look for is the level one information. Level one detail would involve the overall pattern type, which in this instance it's a whorl type pattern, the ridge flow, and some focal areas. This would be the core, or the approximate center of the pattern, and whorls have at least two deltas, which is just a convergence of the ridges. Also with the level one detail, we look at the orientation of the pattern, which means is it face up? In this instance, that's correct. So we're looking at it in the correct orientation. Now we can't make an identification decision at level one. We have to go a little bit further. After we've looked at the level one detail, we go into level two. Level two involves the ridge paths, which if you just follow, that would be each individual ridge. And I like to say the characteristics are the events that occur within the ridge flow. So we have different characteristics that are occurring anytime you see a fingerprint. They are ending ridges, which are just basically ridges that run along and come to a stopping point. We have bifurcations, or ridges which divide, and we have dots, which are ridges that are as wide as they are tall, and they have no direction. Level two not only encompasses characteristics, but also their absence. So if you look, this one is a good example. You have a bifurcation that is opening up, and then you have several ridges which are continuous. And then you have an ending ridge. So when I am doing a comparison, I would look at this bifurcation, and then I would count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 intervening ridges, and then I would come to an ending ridge. So I would look for that in my known print, I would look for that in my latent print, and if those are different, then I would be able to exclude. Now, when we're looking at the characteristics, we're looking at their location, their direction, their type, and their relationship. So it's not that you're just counting a point, you're looking at all the information within that point as well as around it. We can make an individualization decision at level two. So we're looking at level one, level two, and going a step further into level three. Now level three is more on a microscopic level. We don't make a determination on level three alone. But if we have a latent print of poor quality, level 3 information can help us to make a definite decision in the end. Level 3 involves the pores. Your friction ridge structures have pores. Obviously, they exude perspiration, and that's why we leave latent prints when we touch items. Level 3 also involves the, can see them a little bit better, the ridge edges and the widths of the ridges themselves. Okay, you can see the level 3 a little bit better. Can you guys see the yellow? Looks like it's a little bit difficult to see. Can you see, this is just showing you the shapes of the ridges. And different shapes of the ridges actually have been named. So we use those when we are making our decisions. Here is an enlargement of the friction ridge structure, and all the white circles that you can see in there are the pores within the ridges. Okay, so we not only identify individuals based on their fingerprints, we also use the palmar surface of the hands and the entire soles of the feet. Okay, so we have already defined a fingerprint and we've talked about how we compare fingerprints. So just going a step further into inked fingerprints, it's just an intentional reproduction of the friction ridges on the palmar surface of the finger. And inked fingerprints are not only, well, inked fingerprints obviously are only taken using ink, but we also have live scan or the JAB systems that you all have in your field offices. That's just an electronic fingerprint. And there's also chemical heat methods. And that's just when a chemical is applied to the fingers and then it's heated and it turns black, so it looks like an inked print. This is a standard fingerprint card. I'm sure you've all seen them before. I'm sure that you've had your fingerprints taken. Of course you have, because you're all working here. You guys must have done okay past the background. But it's very important when you take individuals' fingerprints that this card is filled out completely. Why is that important? Because this fingerprint card could be used as a court exhibit later. So, and you never know what a defense attorney is going to use against you, so maybe you didn't sign this card when you fingerprinted someone. So you want to make sure that all the descriptive information, the information up in the top, is filled out. If you can get the individual to sign the fingerprint card whose prints were taken, you want to do so. If not, you need to indicate on the card that they refused to sign. You need to make sure that you signed, that you fingerprinted the individual, and you would want the date on there as well. Now, do you all know why we have the rolled fingerprints and then the plain impressions? You know why there's two sets on the card? Anybody? Come on, someone guess. Okay, for more detail. That's one reason. Because in the rolled impressions, as you can see in the top, the fingers are rolled from nail to nail. So you get all the information across the finger, but you can't really get the tips. So when you take the plain impression, you lay the fingers down and you roll them up and lift up. So all of the tips of the fingers, which sometimes that's what we need to make a comparison, are visible down in on the bottom of the card. What would the other reason be? There's two main reasons, and that was one. Nobody? Come on, talk to me, guys. Anything else? Okay, sequence check. If you have an individual, they're not really cooperating, you say, hand me your left index, and they hand you their left middle finger. You may not be paying attention because you're trying to get this done, you're trying to get the card done, but when you do the plain impressions or the slap impressions at the bottom, you are ensured that you're going to have all four of those fingers. Okay? Make sense? Yes? Okay. Talk to me, guys. It's okay. Everyone's quiet this morning. Alrighty. Different methods of recording fingerprints. We already discussed those. Okay. So what is a latent print? Palmar surface of the hand. We have raised portions of skin. Those are known as your friction ridges. I'm sure you guys know this. All these ridges contain pores, and these pores exude perspiration. So when you touch an item, it is possible to leave a latent print. Latent prints are not always visible, so it may require alternate light sources, powders, and chemicals in order to make them able to be seen by the eye. Something else with latent prints is they are usually fragmentary in nature, and that is why we want to make sure that the known prints that we have to compare contain all the information necessary so that we can make a conclusive comparison. Here are just some examples of some latent prints. This one's, it's a little difficult to discern, but you can see the ridges moving in a circular formation. So this is either a loop type or whorl type pattern. You obviously can exclude an arch type pattern because an arch isn't going to flow that way. This is something that we would commonly see in casework. It's just an overlapping, or we would call it a double tap. It's just one latent print on top of another. The last print is an example of when we would use the lower joint. The first joint of the finger, we couldn't use that to make an identification. There's not enough information there. We really can't even see anything there. But the second joint of the finger is nice and clear, and we could use that to do our comparison, as long as we had the available area in the known prints. Depositing latent prints. Now, this is one of the questions that were on the quiz. Every time you touch an item, does that mean a latent print is left? Now, if you've seen anything on TV, you would probably think yes, because according to CSI, you can leave latent prints on plants, animals, whatever. There's no boundaries there. But that isn't always the case. And one thing that's very important is your ridges, your friction ridges, must bear a transfer medium. So if you are in a very cold climate, a very dry climate, and you're not perspiring, then you're probably not going to leave a latent print. Also, latent prints can be left in oils, in blood, in grease, many different transfer mediums. Environmental factors. Weather conditions are very important. Unfortunately, the weather is usually detrimental to not only leaving latent prints, but being able to retrieve them later. If a print is left in perspiration, when we develop those prints, our chemicals and things are reacting with amino acids. Amino acids will dissolve in water. So if it has rained outside, then a lot of times the prints could be washed away. It's just an example of how the environment could be detrimental. We have two basic factors as to why we use fingerprints as a positive means of scientific identification. And the first is individuality. And fingerprints are formed during fetal development, and they are formed based on genetic, environmental, and physical factors in the womb. And friction ridges and their arrangements are unique to each and every individual. This is a twin study that was done, several hundred sets of twins. And what they did is they looked at identical and fraternal twins, and they were trying to get, they were trying to get the closest matching set of fingerprints. Okay? So if you look at these two prints, you have two, you guys remember what that pattern type is? Whorl type pattern. Good. Okay. So obviously, if you look at first glance, you can tell it's a whorl type pattern. The ridge count looks like it's approximately the same. Now, I want you to focus on the delta formation, which is the area that I'm highlighting. There we go. Okay. Now, if you look at this one, you have one continuous ridge, and then you have an ending ridge above that and an ending ridge below that. If you go to the other print, you have two continuous ridges, and you have an ending ridge above that and an ending ridge below that. So do those look the same to you guys? No. That was the closest match that they have found. So that's just to give you an idea of maybe at first glance, yes, two individuals may have the same pattern types, but when you look a little closer, their friction ridge arrangements are going to be different. The second basis is permanence. And fingerprints are formed during fetal development. They remain constant throughout one's life, barring any permanent scarring, until decomposition after death. As long as there's skin on the individual's fingers, we're able to identify them. Okay, this is our little what we need from you slide. This is pretty important. Just some courtesy to us and things to help us do our cases, have things flow a little bit better, actually. So you want to contact the examiner when a case is discontinued. Are you guys working cases already? Yes, okay. So you've probably had cases you've been in the middle of investigating and the case is discontinued for one reason or the next. We just want to get that information so we can stop working the case on our end as well. Also, provide FBI number, descriptive information when requesting comparisons with individuals. A lot of times we'll have individuals call or send us an email and say, hey, can you compare this individual? We need more than just their name, because there's a possibility we'll have the individual in our IAFA system, but to ensure we have the correct individual, if you could provide either date of birth, social security number, any information you have, the more the better. All right, substrates. Depending on the type of evidence, that is going to be one of the things to determine what processes we use. So we have two main types of evidence, porous and non-porous. The other is semi-porous evidence, which is just essentially a combination of the two. So porous evidence would involve paper, cardboard, anything of that nature. Non-porous would be your plastics, your glass, your metal, anything like that. And semi-porous, styrofoam is the best thing that I can think of for semi-porous. Glossy photos, magazine pages, anything where it's not quite a piece of paper, but it is not quite, you know, a piece of plastic where you can't penetrate into the surface. And the difference in these is because porous surfaces are absorbent. Now, this is very important to leaving latent prints. If I touch this piece of paper and I have left a print on this item of evidence, on this substrate, my print is left in the evidence. Porous surfaces absorb prints. So once I touch this item, I now have my left index that is now on this part of this piece of paper. If I rub this piece of paper, that print is not going to come off because my print was absorbed into the specimen. So normal handling will not rub off latent prints. The thing that is important to you all as well is packaging of the items when you submit them to the lab is not detrimental to the latent prints. So for porous items, you can package them in any means that you see necessary, but you don't have to worry about friction rubbing off the prints during packaging. Make sense? Yes? Okay, good. Non-porous surface. Now, non-porous is the exact opposite. Anytime you touch an item and you leave a print on a non-porous surface, if you go back 2 seconds later and wipe that item, that print can be rubbed off. Okay? So it's very, very important that latent prints on non-porous surfaces are preserved as soon as possible, there's no friction against them, and you have to take special care when you are packaging them and submitting them to the laboratory. Because if you have a print, you guys might have a visible print you can see on an item of evidence. Oh, this is so good, I'm just going to submit it to the lab. And the way that you sent it caused some friction. By the time it got to us, it wasn't an identifiable print. So you don't want your evidence to be ruined just because you submitted it to the lab and it wasn't packaged correctly. This is why, and we are going to get into this a little later today, why we want non-porous specimens to be lightly superglued before they are submitted to the laboratory. Once you superglue a print, then you've pretty much, as long as you don't scrape it, that print isn't coming off. So that ensures that your evidence is going to be intact and your prints are going to make it in your transition from your field office to the laboratory. Selection of processes not only is determined by the surface type that we've already discussed, but it can be determined by the transfer medium. Was the print left in perspiration? Was the print left in blood? Are there greases and oils involved? And because of that, we have different processes that we use. Also, surface condition. If you guys go into a crime scene, maybe your crime scene is outside and it's rainy and it's wet, are you going to use powder? No, because all it's going to do is clump up and you're just going to have a big dirty mess. So obviously that is not going to be your most effective method that you would be using at that time. Okay, so just to give you an idea, a porous sequence that we would use in the lab. First thing we do anytime we get an item of evidence is we do a visual examination. We want to look at that item of evidence. We want to look at all angles, use oblique lighting. Then we want to do a light source exam. We're going to use UV light, laser light, the crime scope, any alternate light sources we see fit. Iodine fuming is something that we don't do a whole lot anymore. The evidence has to be less than 30 days old, and there are different instances when we might use iodine fuming. One of the more common things, chemicals that we use in the laboratory, is DFO. And DFO, it's an acronym for 1,8-diazofluorine-9-one. You guys don't need to know that. But what you do need to know is that it is a chemical that reacts with amino acids that are left behind in perspiration. So it's a spray that we use, and then we actually heat it in an oven, and we look at prints under forensic light sources. After we use DFO, we use ninhydrin. Ninhydrin is another chemical that reacts with amino acids. The reason we use the two is because there are different amino acids that are produced in the body, and those two chemicals work with different amino acids. The last thing we do in our porous processing sequences is physical developer. Now, physical developer is important because it reacts with sebaceous materials. So if an item of evidence has been wet and maybe the amino acids dissolved, you can check and see if any prints were left in oil. So hope is not lost just because an item of evidence was wet. Hopefully we can get those prints using physical developer. The non-porous processing sequence, any processing sequence is going to start out the same, visual and light source exam. The non-porous processing sequence you guys are going to use more than you would use the porous because you are going to be doing cyanoacrylate fuming or superglue, and you're going to hear about that next. After superglue, something that we use in the lab is a cyanoacrylate dye stain, and the one we use most commonly in the lab is known as RAM. You guys are going to get a lecture on that as well. And RAM is just something that you squirt on an item that has been superglued, and it dyes those ridges so that we're able to, the ridges will fluoresce and we're able to see it under a forensic light source. VMD, or vacuum metal deposition, is used in special cases after RAM has been done. And the last step in the processing sequence is powder. Now, this is something important for you guys to note. I know that you go out, especially if you're new in ERT and you want to go out to your crime scenes and you want to do the best you possibly can, so you want to break out your powder and you want to try to get fingerprints on everything possible. Well, if there are items of evidence that can be sent to the lab and you can't superglue them at the crime scene, then you want to send them to us because you want them to be glued, plus we can do RAM at the lab before powder. Powder is always the last step in the processing sequence. Bloodstained porous items, just very briefly. Bloodstained items, you are going to do all your porous processing and then you're going to do the blood process. And the only difference with bloodstained non-porous is you do the blood process before you superglue. And that is because superglue is detrimental to different exams with blood. Okay, quality control. If you do have to use chemicals in the field, let's go ahead and talk about this. Your processing guide that we put out to you guys. Obviously, you want to read everything at the top. This is very important. Also, there's an EC that was dated July 5th, 2005, but it came from the ERTU, and it states what you all are supposed to be doing in the field. We have a lot of field offices where the ERT agents like to do a little bit more, which it's always nice when people like to do a little bit more, but sometimes doing more is actually detrimental to our exams. So, just as an example, if you have something very important to note is these little asterisks, if not portable. So, if you see with the items that you are powdering, they all say if they are not portable, which means you shouldn't be powdering out in the field unless something is not able to be submitted to the laboratory. Now, I know this isn't always going to happen, and I know that you do whatever your superiors are going to tell you to do. We just want you to use this as a guide and know that this is our preferred method as far as the laboratory goes and the ERT unit at the laboratory. So make sure you guys use this as a guide. quality control if you are using chemicals. The only time you would need to use RAM in the field is say you have a big giant white refrigerator. It can't be submitted to the field. You've super glued it. It's white. Super glued ridges appear as white ridges. So they're going to be difficult to visualize on a white refrigerator. So you have it in a dark space. If you're able to somehow make a tent over it so that you can see, you're going to squirt RAM on that item, and you're going to look at it under a fluorescent light source, forensic light source. That's one example of when you might use RAM in the field, something that you can't submit into the lab. Okay, just to reiterate, this is an important slide. You guys should probably write all this down. If an item is immovable, process it at the scene. If a non-porous item can be sent to the lab, lightly super glue it and submit it to the lab. All porous items should be sent to the lab for processing. And if there is any question at all, please contact the ERT unit for your protocols. Let's do a little review here. You want to ship items according to specimen type. So what kind of items do not require special packaging? Porous. That's right. Okay, what kind of items require that specimens do not come in contact with each other or packaging? Non-porous. Very good. Okay. Lightly super gluing prior to shipping can reduce potential damage from friction. So that's why we ask that you do super glue items of evidence lightly and die stress lightly, which you guys are going to get into that a little bit later today. You want to secure items in place for shipping. Guns need to go in gun boxes with zip ties. Guns are very, very important. It is very difficult to develop identifiable latent prints on guns. There's actually research that has been done. We only get prints about 5 to 10% of the time, prints that we can identify on weapons. So something that's very important is the shipping of the weapons into the laboratory. So you want to use your gun boxes that I know you all have at all your field offices, and you want to use your zip ties or your flex cuffs or whatever you guys want to call them, and you want to make sure that that gun is secured in that gun box so that it can't move around a lot in the shipping. Ziploc bags. If you don't have any gun boxes and you have to, well, we want to use the gun boxes for guns, so I'm not going to address that with guns. Heat-sealed bags do reduce movement. And if you don't have a heat-sealed bag, you can use Ziploc bags and you can staple around the item of evidence. So all you want to do is you want to reduce movement and reduce friction in the shipping. The source material for this is in your processing guide that you all received. And also you have your ERT latent processing guide to look at as well. Are there any questions?
Cyanoacrylate fuming, just the scientific name for superglue fuming. This is basically the best process that we've found so far for developing latent prints on non-porous surfaces. So your glass, your metal, your plastic, any basically hard surfaces, we found this is the best method of developing latent prints. And there's a number of different ways that you can apply superglue to objects. There's chambers like we use in the lab. There's these wands that we'll show you as well. It's basically like a butane lighter with a super glue tip on the end, so it just kind of sprays glues out the end. There's also a thing that didn't get shipped here today, but each of your field offices should have, called the CBC or cyanoacrylate blowing chamber, which is basically just like a giant super glue wand. It looks kind of like a vacuum cleaner and has various attachments for it, but it's the same thing with a heater and a blower, and it blows out super glue fumes out of a big tube, and it works pretty well. So all your field offices should have that. Unfortunately, we don't have it here today to show it to you. Except through a picture, but we'll get to that. The main thing you guys are going to be doing is gluing in some makeshift chambers that you guys are going to build. So let's get to this. What is cyanoacrylate fuming? Basically, it's just it's super glue. It was accidentally discovered in the 1970s by Japanese workers at Kodak. A worker basically put an open bottle of super glue, not realizing it was still open, in a drawer with a bunch of photographs. And when he came back the next morning, the fingerprints that had been on these photographs were hardened in super glue. And he basically, as most good science has done, accidentally discovered that super glue reacts with the moisture and latent print residue and forms a nice plasticized print that's basically indestructible after that. So it started to be used in the early 80s by the FBI, and we've used it ever since. And again, it's basically the workhorse of the latent print unit for non-porous items. It works very well on non-porous items. Again, your plastics, tape, garbage bags, etc. It'll also work on what we call semi-porous items, which are kind of items that are in between porous and non-porous. Things like styrofoam, magazine pages, rubber gloves, those kind of things will super glue as well. So to get scientific, that just went away. There it's back. It can be ethyl or methyl cyanoacrylate. Basically, if you buy super glue in a store, it's going to work. And the two big words to know why it works is basically volatilization and polymerization, which is basically just heating it into a gas and then having it harden. So volatilization, this occurs when we apply a large amount of heat to super glue and it basically boils and becomes a gas. So that's the volatilization part. Usually this is done through a heater. It can also be done through those the butane fuming wands, but it's basically you just need a large heat source. We turn them up all the way. We use high heat to vaporize that glue into a gas. Again, the longer or the higher the temperature, the less time it'll take to volatilize it. So generally, we just take those heaters and crank them up all the way to high, which we've measured at about 300 to 400 degrees centigrade, so they're hot. And again, by the time you put that glue on there, it's a matter of seconds before it starts to volatilize. It can occur at room temperature. If anybody's ever seen Beverly Hills Cop, when he takes, like, I think it's a matchbook and a little tin of super glue and puts it in an aquarium, and then the prints develop, that will work. It just takes a longer amount of time. Generally, if you do it that method, it's just going to, like, leave it out for, bless you, several hours or overnight, and you'll get reaction that way. So polymerization, after you volatilize the super glue into a gas, it's then going to bind to the moisture that's left in the latent print residue and form a plasticized print made out of super glue. And it works whether it's ecrin, which is a sweat residue, or sebaceous, which is kind of fats and oils. Somebody's rubbed their forehead and then touched something and left it a fatty or oily print. It'll work with any of that latent print residue. And basically, it just forming a plasticized fingerprint impression. You can imagine when you've used super glue before. Once it hardens, it hardens. And if it's on an item like plastic or metal or glass, it's not going to come off unless you use some type of harsh chemical. Or actually scrape it off to damage it. So it's pretty indestructible. The one thing you have to be careful of with super glue is to overexpose items, which is basically just gluing them for too long and exposing them to vapors for too long. It is super glue, so eventually it's going to stick to everything, not just the latent print residue. It's just going to start to stick to everything, and you're just going to basically paint the surface white. And at that point, you can imagine if you've over super glued something, it's not coming off. We can't, you know, scrape around the print and carve out where the ridges were. Once you've overglued something, it's overglued. So like on this and some other things, you'll see it says lightly super glue. We definitely want you to err on the side of lightly gluing something rather than overgluing something. We can always add a little more glue if we need to at the lab to build up the print a little bit. But if it's already been overglued, at that point it's pretty much done and we have to work with what's left. So the main thing is just not to overexpose items. And you'll see we're going to have you do gluing for different amounts of time so you get a feel for, you know, is 30 seconds enough, is a minute enough, is 2 minutes enough, so you get a feel for how long is too long. And it also depends on the size of the chamber. If you have a very small box or something you're using, obviously it's not going to take very long. If you have a large chamber, you can fume something for longer. We have giant walk-in chambers that we can put, I've done ladders and chairs and all kinds of stuff, large items in these chambers. There we fume it for about 10 minutes because it takes a while. You got a big chamber. But if you have a smaller chamber like this box, sometimes just a minute or two is going to be enough to fume an item. We use what's called the microburst fuming method, which is just high heat and a lot of glue over a short period of time. So that's what we call it. We found this works the best. But again, if you don't have a heat source, Derek and I were doing some training over in Kyrgyzstan a few months ago, and we didn't have the heaters. We just took a tin of glue and put it in a box out in the hot sun. And within an hour or so, there was some development already. So depending on the temperature and where you're at, sometimes just leaving it out in the sun for a while, again, the sun will get hot enough and the glue will start to vaporize, and you can develop prints that way. What we have in the lab is they're built by a company called Misonix. There's a picture in a second. We use those. The CBC I mentioned, or these handheld fuming wands, which you'll get a little chance to experiment with today. We call it a line of sight process, which basically means that only the areas obviously exposed to superglue fumes are going to react with it. So if I was going to glue, you know, for example, this computer or something, if I have it placed in here in the chamber, there's no way the fumes can get to the bottom of this item because it's touching the surface. So what you would want to do is prop it up somehow so that then the fumes can get all the way around and they're going to get underneath and process underneath. If not, you're going to have to find some other way to process something that's underneath. So basically we hang things in the chambers so that the fumes can get all the way around them. And if you set them on the ground or on the bottom of the chamber, anything that's on the bottom is not going to get fumes. So we do a lot of leaning on the side or hanging from above so that way the fumes can get to the entire surface. These are the chambers we have in the laboratory. We have a few different sizes. This is the smaller of the three. And basically you can see the clips in here. We just hang stuff from there. There's a heater in here. Again, it gets up to about 300 degrees centigrade. We just open this door here and put in a tin of glue. And it's got a fan over here that runs to blow the fumes so they get to. We've set things in all corners of here to test it, and the fumes get everywhere in there, so we don't have to worry about, you know, where to hang it. The fumes get to everywhere in that chamber. We also have ones that are about twice as big and they're long like this that we can put rifles and longer items in there. And we also, again, have those walk-in, basically the size of a walk-in closet. It's basically like a small room that we just basically fume the entire room. These are the wands that you're going to be using. We'll show you a little bit more about how to use that, but basically it's just kind of like a butane lighter that lights up, and then you put these tips from this tube. The tips have super glue in them. You stick them on the end, and in about a few minutes those tips will heat up and the glue will start coming out that way. And these are the CBCs that I was talking about, where basically there's just a heater inside and a fan, and it's going to blow it out this tube. And then there's different attachments that you can put on the end. So if you wanted to fume, say, just a doorknob, you can put this attachment over the end and just stick it over there, and it forms like a very small chamber over the doorknob area or something like that. It's also used in the advanced class. We talk about developing prints on human skin. It can be used with some of those. They're kind of a curved. Some of these have kind of a curved thing, so you can actually put them over a person's leg or arm and make and super glue that way. We talk about it more in the advanced class, but to develop latent prints on skin is just basically you're super gluing the skin and then using magnetic powder is what we found is the best method for developing prints on skin. And usually it takes a pretty concentrated amount of super glue, and it doesn't work all that often and it has to be done within a day. Those are the main points for developing latent prints on skin. Oh, I'm sorry, question, go ahead. Right in front of me. I know it's kind of like the package that you open and leave.
It's like the little canister.
Oh, right. We generally don't. We like the method where we just use the heaters and actually place the glue on there. I know those work, and obviously anything that works, we're not going to discourage. And those work also because you don't need a plug. So, I mean, obviously if you're out somewhere and don't have a generator and can't plug in a heater, you know, those work. There's also, what's it called, Loctite or... where it's just like a package that you rip open and you could put it like on the inside of a car and close the door and come back in a few hours. And those work too. Again, if you don't have access to electricity, you don't have a generator or a power source, then these are good ways of being able to glue in the field. Again, if it's not a hot sunny day, you know, if it's in the winter or something, it might not work. But yeah, those work. We recommend anytime you have access to electricity and the heaters and the glue tins that that's our preferred method, but those will work too. If your field office has those, you might want to experiment with them first just to get a feel for how much, again, is over-gluing and how much is under-gluing. But those work, especially if you don't have a power source. So some other methods. You can accelerate this by placing sodium hydroxide on cotton. You can actually, that basically heats the cotton, and you can actually put glue in the cotton and it'll fume that way. And there's also, as she just mentioned, different commercial fingerprint packages. And basically those are designed to work without needing a heat source or electricity. So the microburst processing procedure is basically you're just going to have super glue, these small aluminum tins that we're going to be using today, and then some type of fuming chamber. If you just go and try to glue something outside on a breezy day like this, you're going to see the fumes blowing everywhere. You need something that's going to contain those fumes, a chamber, a bag, something that the fumes are going to get trapped in so they get exposed to that item for the correct amount of time. And then the heater cranked up all the way. Again, they're about 400 degrees Celsius, so they're hot. And then the amount of glue, again, it depends on the size of the fuming chamber and the amount of time in there. And that's what we want you guys to experiment with today, just to get an idea of how long it takes to over-glue or under-glue an item. So here's our very own MK preparing to fume an item. She's got some guns that she's putting in our chamber. You can see, again, she's hanging them or leaning them against the walls in here, again, to get the maximum amount of fumes around everywhere. Even though it doesn't look like it, this is just touching the wall here, so the fumes are going to get everywhere except that, you know, extremely small part on the rim where it's just touching the wall. So again, we want to get the fumes everywhere. If you're doing guns, we recommend, you can see she's got tape over the barrels here and also the other openings. If it's going to have to go to firearms for examination, test firing, ballistics exam, whatever, super glue can sometimes get in the barrel and interfere with their exams. So anytime you can prevent that, it's recommended. I've had some firearms examiners say if something's just lightly glued, you know, it doesn't mess with them at all. I've heard others say, you know, keep all the super glue you can out of there. So we recommend you try and keep as much out of there as possible if it needs a firearms exam. So there's a little close-up, and you can see the tape over the barrel openings. And then afterwards, basically we'll just look at it sometimes with just a strong white light or with a device called a RUVIS that we're going to show you later, which is very good for looking at super glue processed items. This is just a Diet Coke can that's been super glued. It's actually under a alternate light source, but you can see a good print right there and all the detail. Prints with super glue aren't going to look like they do on a fingerprint card. They're actually going to look white, usually on a dark surface, as opposed to a fingerprint card, which is black ridges on a white background. So you'll see it looks like this, where you've got the actual ridges are in white. And again, if you have a white item, say I left prints on here and then super glued this, you're going to have white super glue on a white item. You're then going to need some other method probably to be able to see those prints. Generally, we'll show you how to use the RUVIS for that. You could then apply a cyanoacrylate dye stain, which I'll talk about in a minute. Or the good thing is fingerprint powder will also adhere to the super glue, which is why we do super glue first and not powder first. If you powder something first, it absorbs. The powder is designed to absorb all the moisture in that fingerprint residue, so there's not going to be anything left for super glue to react with. As opposed to super gluing first, you still take up that fingerprint residue, but the powders will bind to the super glue. So that's why we do it in the order that we do. So basically, once you've powdered something, there's no fingerprint residue left exposed for anything else to develop with. So once something's powdered, that's pretty much it. So that's why we do powdering last, because nothing else can be done. It's only if you need to make it visible. For example, if I left a print on this white board and super glued it, you've got white super glue on this white board, you're not going to be able to see it. The powder is just to make it visible. So if you put black powder there, it would then adhere to the super glue and you'd be able to make it visible. So again, it's okay, definitely okay to underfume an item. You can always, if it looks underfumed, add a little bit more glue, or we can do it at the lab. But again, once it's overfumed, we can't do anything with it. So we just want to make sure that, you know, it stays on the underfumed side of things rather than overfuming. Precautions, as I mentioned, it's detrimental to firearms exams. It doesn't actually degrade the DNA, but it's just putting a super glue covering over the DNA so that they can't get to it in order to do their exams. So it's not that super glue destroys the DNA, it's just you're putting a film of plastic basically over the DNA, and then when they swab, they don't get anything because it's under that layer of super glue. So that's why DNA needs to be swabbed for first, because after you super glue it, there's no way for them to actually get to any DNA to swab it. And generally, blood processes are done first, again, for the same reason. The super glue will adhere to the moisture in blood, but again, it's going to put a plastic layer over it, so there's not that many chemicals that will pierce through the super glue in order to still react with the blood. Now, again, if you just have the plain super glue, it's going to dry fast, so just, you know, common recommendations are not to get any on your skin. Wash it off if you do. We generally wear cotton gloves in the lab, but we wear latex gloves over those cotton gloves. You just want to act, if you have, again, sodium hydroxide with cotton will form a heat reaction, so you just want to avoid sometimes getting the super glue on the gloves, cotton gloves. Cleanup and storage. The good thing about this process is there's nothing toxic that's generated. Except the fumes, you're going to find that out, but that's all going to go away. The waste itself, you're just going to be able to throw off all the tins, the chambers that we're making out of the boxes. Everything is disposable. You don't need to worry about chemicals that need to be collected for hazardous materials collection and that sort of thing. If you do have super glue that you're storing at your field office, you can just keep it in the original bottle and place it in the refrigerator if you like to make it last a little longer. But basically, there's nothing that just leaving super glue out is going to cause it to go bad or anything. This is talked about in the processing guides that you guys have, and a lot of it will probably become clearer when we're actually out there doing the practical. This is what we're going to be doing. I'm going to talk about the dye stain first, just while we're all here, before we do the practical. But when you guys do the practical, as is often the case with ERT, we're going to rig something up that works. I was over in Republic of Georgia, and we were processing a bunch of stolen cars that were out of LA. I know you guys, a lot of you are from LA. If any of you know Tony Tyndall, tell him I say hi. But basically, we're just going to be using cardboard boxes, which is what we used over there. You're going to seal up the back, basically, with some tape. You're going to cut a hole in the top and tape this clear plastic to basically give you a window into the box. It also serves as a way you can put fingerprints on the other side, and it serves as a test strip. So when you see those prints develop on the other side, you know that the reaction has occurred. You can take a garbage bag in some form. I'm not going to go all the way here, but to use as a way to cover this opening so you can then flip it up, put your things in there, and then flip this down to keep all the super glue fumes in there, and they'll be cycling around inside there, which you'll be able to see through the window. So that's basically it. You're going to have a heater, which will basically just go in inside here, and a tin with some glue. So that's basically how the practical is going to work. We've got a ton of just stuff here to glue. Again, if you were doing this in the field, you're going to glue it and then send it in to us because they're small, portable items. We just want to get an idea of you know, what it takes to glue something. We recommend, you know, try 30, 60, 90 seconds, 2 minutes, get to the point where you've over-fumed something so you can see it. What we recommend, when you first get the heaters, plug them in and turn them on, because they're going to take 5 to 10 minutes before they're at full heat, so that while you're building your chambers here, the heaters are getting up to the heat. Put them in there, seal it up. You're going to want to put a couple items in there. Once you see the fumes start going, you know, somebody time 30 seconds, and then take those items out, and then start the whole process over for 60 seconds, 90 seconds, and 2 minutes. We have some groups that try to shortcut themselves, and they'll put, you know, 4 items in there and cover it up, and then every 30 seconds take something else out. It doesn't work that way, because every time you open up the thing, the cover, the fumes are going to come out, and it's not going to be a true representation of if you had something in there for 2 minutes. So take the time. This is again, one of the best processes we have for developing things on non-porous items. It's something you're going to use a lot. So get comfortable with it to the point where if you get something in the field, you're going to be able to say, oh, let's put that in a box, and it's going to take, you know, 60 seconds for it to fume properly. But if we put it in there for a minute and a half, it's going to be too long. We just want you to get comfortable with basically what's right and wrong with super gluing. Any questions on that? This is a method, it's a chemical method of staining super glue so that you can then see it with an alternate light source, such as a crime scope would be the most popular thing that you guys would use in the field. In the lab, we use a laser. It's just a little more powerful version of a crime scope, but the crime scopes work just as well. Again, it's just a method to visualize super glue prints on items. It's only been taught to the ERTs for the last year or so, so it's relatively new. Again, it's something you would use on a large, immovable, non-porous item that you need to be able to visualize super glue on in the field. So the best example we come up with is something like a large white refrigerator, a vending machine, something like that, that it's not feasible that you take that and send it to the laboratory, although we have gotten large items in like that before, safes and ATM machines and stuff like that. But again, it's not practical to send in refrigerators and vending machines all the time. So what we'd recommend is that you would glue those items probably with the handheld wand or the CBC. And then again, if you have a white refrigerator, you're not going to be able to see those prints very well on the refrigerator. You could then use the Rubus, which we'll show you. You could apply the RAM to it to make it visible. And most likely you're just going to apply powder to it, would be the easiest method. But something like a vending machine where there might be a lot of colors involved, the RAM can work very well because the prints fluoresce, so that it takes away all those background colors. So you might have various colors in the background that if you powdered it, you might only be able to see one side of the print or the other because of the different colors in the background. Whereas if you stain it with the RAM and shine the light on it, the print fluoresces and it leaves all the background behind. So that's basically the examples we give. It's not something you're going to be using all the time, but we at least want to let you guys know that it's out there. I apologize if you were in Woodbridge taking the course. We actually have the RAM there and show it to you how it works because it's a kind of a regulated chemical. It was hard to get it shipped here for the class, but we're going to show you what it looks like so you at least get an idea. Anybody else that's been to in your field office that's been to the advanced or basic classes that's actually seen it, you can ask them basically what it looks like. Again, it's just a fluorescent dye stain that stains super glue. It's called RAM, which is basically just an acronym for the three chemicals that are involved, rhodamin, Ardrox, and MBD. Each one of these separately works as a dye stain as well. They just work in different wavelengths. By combining these three together, we can then use pretty much any wavelength that's on your crime scope. So the advantage of using RAM is that it doesn't matter if you're using ultraviolet light, blue light, green light, it'll fluoresce with any one of those. So we recommend you use something on your crime scope between 365, which is in the UV range, and 535, which is in the green range. All of your crime scopes have what's called a CSS, or crime scene search setting on them. That's pretty much one of the best settings for general forensic use, so we'd recommend using that. And this was developed by actual latent examiners that are still in our unit working today, but it was developed in 1990 by a couple of examiners. Here's that same picture again. Again, this is the fingerprint that's been stained with RAM. So when you mix it, for the ERT, it comes in these just small little vials. It's a little liquid. You basically pour it into a 1 liter container and then fill that container with methanol. So it's basically just adding methanol to this stock solution that you'd buy from a chemical company. Talk to your team leaders if they haven't purchased it already, but they know about it. And it's the kind that we make in the lab involves us mixing together like 20 different chemicals. But the one that we recommend for you guys is just this concentrate you buy from chemical companies and add methanol to it. It is light sensitive, so you want to either store it in a dark bottle or in a dark area, in a cabinet or something. So again, you've got this RAM concentrate and methanol. If you look in the processing guide, you're going to see a laundry list of chemicals. Don't worry about that. This is the way that we recommend ERT makes it up in the field, just so it's a lot easier and involves a lot less chemicals. There's different ways of applying it. We basically just put it in a squirt bottle and squirt it on there, but you can also spray it on there with a spray bottle or actually just take an item and submerge it in there. The problem with submerging it in there is it can contaminate the rest of the solution, so you might just dunk it once and then the rest of the solution is unusable. Whereas when you squirt it on, you're just controlling the amount that you use, and the rest of it's just in a squirt bottle for later use. So again, this only works on surfaces that have been superglued. Obviously, if you pour chemicals onto an untreated surface, you're gonna rinse those latent prints away. So it's only to be used once you've superglued an item. And again, it works on non-porous and semi-porous surfaces. We got a good print in the basic class last week on a styrofoam cup using this. Again, if you can imagine, I thought I saw one over here. You got a styrofoam cup, and you touch that and then superglue it. You've got white superglue on this white item. It's just not very visible. We squirted RAM on it and put it under the light, and the print fluoresced so we could see it. And it turned out pretty good. The RAM is just a photography technique, so you're not gonna process it with the RAM and try and lift it or anything after that. It's just photography. You're gonna have a light on it, and you're looking at it through generally orange filtered glasses. So you're gonna tell your photographer, I had this on CSS setting on my crime scope, and I looked through it through orange glasses, and they'll put it on that setting and put an orange filter over their camera lens so that they can then take the picture as you saw it. So here's how we would do it in the laboratory. Again, it's an orange liquid. It's just coming out of a squirt bottle, and you just squirt it on there. You want to put on, in this case, unlike superglue, you want to put on more than enough, because you want to make sure that there's enough RAM that's coated the entire surface that's been superglued. So usually we just keep rotating around and squirting. Again, too much is better than not enough in this case, because if you don't stain part of it, you're not going to see it when you put it under the light source. So again, it's used in conjunction with laser and alternate light sources. Our laser is at 532 nanometers. which is how we look at it. But the good thing about the RAM mixed all together is you can pretty much have it on any wavelength of your crime scope and it'll work. So we suggest you use the orange filter. And again, generally the CSS setting with orange filtered glasses is usually the best for seeing RAM prints. And then you would just tell your photographer. If for some reason you use different wavelength or a different colored glasses to see it, again, just tell your photographer so that when they're taking these prints, they know what settings to have the crime scope on, as well as what filter to put over their camera lens. So here's an example. Again, you're just shining the light. In this case, it's our older laser on here. You'd view it through the glasses, and you would see this print that's fluorescing. Basically, what those orange filters are doing is blocking out all of the low-level light so that all you see is the light that's fluorescing off of the print. Now, these RAM prints, if you have processed something, they will fade over time. It's not going to be immediate, but you want to have it photographed, you know, generally that... I mean, ERT doesn't have to really worry about this. This is more in the lab when we're sending something to our photography department. We have to tell them, you know, please make sure this gets photographed within a few days, as opposed to, you know, sitting somewhere and the print's fading away. ERT is obviously going to be processing and having it photographed immediately, so it's probably not something you have to worry about. If for some reason it does fade away, it is possible to rejuvenate it by just squirting some more over it. Sometimes that doesn't work, but a lot of times it does just by reapplying it. If you expose it to a light source and just have that light source shining on there for an extended period of time, it can also cause them to fade away. But generally, you know, the photographers are going to shine it on there, take a picture, and that's going to be done with it. But if you do have it on there for an extended period of time, and again, this is probably going to be you know, a matter of hours, it can fade away as well. Once you've made up this solution, it's good for about 6 months, and you want to store it in dark bottles. So the benefits of RAM, it's an additional step. It works well on super glued items, again, that are either white or have a lot of colors in them, because the background will go away when the print fluoresces. And it covers multiple wavelengths of fluorescence. So pretty much any colored light you shine on it from your crime scope, you'll be able to see the prints. We mentioned before, unlike with super glue, you can just throw all the stuff out when you're done. This is a regulated chemical because of the methanol that's in it. So in the lab, we have to collect it in a bin, and then the hazardous waste handler has to come and dispose of it. Generally, if you just collect it in something and let it evaporate, it'll generally evaporate away because of the alcohol in it. If you have an excessive amount of it, you're probably going to want to collect it and then take it back to your field office and have somebody come and dispose of it properly. And again, this is in at least how to process things with RAM. Again, ignore the how to make it in the processing guides, because you guys are going to be doing it a lot easier. The next three things that we're going to do quickly here for lunch, we're then going to come back after lunch and break up into three groups and rotate through these next three things. And each of you guys are going to see how to do each of these three things. The first one we're going to talk about is called the RUVIS. It's a way of viewing either super glued fumed prints, or a lot of times you don't even need to super glue fume the prints. It's just a way of visualizing latent prints. It's a relatively new sort of technology that we've been using in the lab, and had some really good results with it. So that's what we're going to talk about now. So we want you to understand the properties. What we're using with this is called shortwave UV light. It's 254 nanometer light, which there's a few safety concerns we want to make you aware of, but it works very well for developing latent prints. And what we're calling the RUVIS is an acronym, just like everything else in the Bureau. It stands for Reflective Ultraviolet Imaging System. So we're going to talk a little bit about UV light, the components of the RUVIS, some safety, when to use it in your processing sequences, and some case examples, and then we'll do the hands-on part. Will come after lunch. But a little bit about ultraviolet light. It's all around you outside. If you're like me, it doesn't react well with your skin. It turns it a nice red burn color. Some of the other people are lucky and get nice and tan, but not me. So there's three different types of UV light, UV A, B, and C. The kind we're using with this is the short wave, which is under 280 nanometers. Again, this is kind of technical, but the long wave is generally what you'll use for fluorescence. That's what's on your crime scopes. It's what we use in the lab for fluorescence. But what we're dealing with here is reflective light, and we're using this shortwave UV light. So if you remember, shorter the wavelength, the higher the intensity, so that's why it's a little bit, this is very intense UV light. So It can burn if you leave it on for too long, but we'll get to that in a second. So again, what we're using in this is 254 nanometer light. So this was again first used in Japan in the 70s, and in the 80s their police agency started using it for detecting latent prints. The Army started using it over in the US in the 90s, and we developed or started using it in the laboratory in the early 2000s. So how does it work? Unlike fluorescence, what we're dealing with here is actually just reflecting UV light. So if you remember just from high school physics or whatever, you take a light, you shine it on a surface, it then reflects off of that surface. So we're going to use that property in order to detect latent prints with this. So in this case, if you imagine that there's latent print residue on this surface here, and I apologize, different computers show different things with this slide, how the animation works. But basically you're shining the UV light down onto this residue, and it's going to cause it to scatter in all different directions instead of just reflecting off. Some will still reflect off, but some of it's going to hit this latent print residue here, and it's going to scatter it to all different directions. And that's what we're relying on in order to visualize the latent prints with this. Because what we want to happen, ideally, is to have this UV light hit this latent print residue and then scatter, and at some point it's going to scatter up into the RUVA system itself through a filter and into an intensifier, and that's what's going to allow you to see this the latent prints. So there's different ways that you can have it reflect up into this intensifier. You can then attach a camera to it. You can just have an eyepiece on it, which is what you guys will use after lunch. Or in the lab, we actually have it hooked up to a monitor, and then we can see the prints on the monitor. So this is how we have it set up. Here's your UV light. You're shining it onto an object that has the latent print residue on it. It's scattering everywhere, but it's also going to scatter up into this intensifier through that filter. And then we have it hooked up to a monitor where we can actually see the prints on there. Now, you guys are just going to have just an eyepiece on the end of this, and you're just going to hold up and look through it directly. And the photographers can actually just attach a camera to it and take pictures through it as well. So you've got the shortwave UV light. The best thing about this is it works in broad daylight or in complete darkness. So after lunch, we're just going to use the side of that truck, and you're just going to shine the RUVIS right on it. And even though there's direct sunlight on it, you're still going to be able to see the prints clear as day. As opposed to the RAM, if we were to use that, it's going to need to be in a dark room so that when you shine the light on it, you'll be able to see the fluorescence coming off of it. But the RUVIS will work in broad daylight, which is nice. It works excellent on multicolored backgrounds. It drops almost everything in the background out of it, as you'll see in some photos coming up here. You don't have to put the stain on it at all, so we use this before we put RAM on anything. You can use it after super glue, it works very well, but also it'll just work on basically raw latent print residue. So this is a good tool you can use when you just first come on a scene and just shine it around and see if there's any latent prints without doing any processing whatsoever. And you'll see the stuff on the side of the truck is just going to be palm prints on the side of the truck. They were just placed there. They haven't been super glued or processed in any way. And we want to get into a little bit of this angle of incidence. Because you're reflecting that light and trying to get the light to scatter up into that intensifier, you'll notice that as you change the angle of the light, the prints will get more intense and less intense. So you'll see that you have to keep the light moving around to be able to see the prints the best way possible. It'll be more apparent when you actually do the practical this afternoon. But don't just hold it at one angle and move along. You have to keep that light moving, again, because you want that light to scatter off the latent print residue into your intensifier. And there'll be times that you might hold it at too shallow an angle, and it's not going to scatter into the intensifier. It's just going to reflect off into space, and you won't see it. So a little bit about safety. Again, the ultraviolet light is shortwave, so it's more intense. So what you don't want to do is just have it shining directly on your skin. Or into your eyes. So you use just clear UV protectant safety glasses to keep the UV light out of your eyes. In the lab, we have gloves and coats on. Usually you'll be processing with gloves on anyway. You may want to have some sleeves on. The main thing is just as long as you're processing with the light facing away from you, you'll be fine. We had an examiner that was processing. He basically put the light back here shining towards him as he was marking items, and he was doing that for about an hour. He basically ended up with kind of equivalent to a sunburn, but also he had problems with his eyes, again, because of the UV light constantly shining into his eyes. He didn't have the glasses on for like an hour. So it's equivalent to kind of like what's called a welder's burn, but it's basically, you know, you just are burning the corneas in your eyes from this UV light. So please wear the glasses that come with the kit. And again, this can also be avoided by just having the light being reflected away from you. Don't work with the light shining at you. And again, it's not like if the light just, you know, comes by you, it's going to burn you automatically. This is a continuous exposure is going to cause these problems. So the best thing about Ruvus, again, it's non-destructive, so you can use it at any point and just see if you see any latent prints. So when you first come on the scene, shine it around, see if there's any latent prints. You can do it after super glue, but it's non-destructive. So it's one of those things, you know, try it, see if it works. The worst thing that happens is you don't get any latent prints at that point, but you can try it, and a lot of times you will get some prints. It's real time, so as you're looking through there, you're seeing the prints. There's no delay. It works, you know, works great in the laboratory and also at crime scenes. Again, it works in broad daylight, takes away backgrounds. Even if it's weakly super glued, it can enhance those. It also works for other applications with trace evidence and footwear impressions and that sort of thing. Now the cons. Every ERT, as far as I know, has at least one of these things at a cost of about $12,000 for a system, what we'll be using. So they work really well, but again, they're costly, and there's a few pieces that are easily breakable as opposed to other pieces. You just want to be careful when you're handling it, because they do work well, but they just are a little bit costly. Again, that angle of incidence can be annoying, because if you don't have the light angled just right, you may not see the prints. So that's just one of the things with the Ruvus you have to be wary of. It doesn't work on porous, again, because we're dealing with reflection. So UV light is not going to hit a porous item and reflect off. If you shine on this piece of paper, it's just going to be absorbed into that paper. You need to have surfaces that will reflect light in order for this to work. A lot of times if it's highly reflective, it may not work because everything's just going to reflect off of it. And if you can imagine something that's crumpled, like crumpled up aluminum foil, if you're shining a light on that, it's going to just scatter all over. So something that's a lot very crumpled, it may not be able to scatter up into that intensifier. It's just going to be all over the place. So sometimes it doesn't work on crumpled items. It does impact DNA exams. Again, if you just pass UV light over DNA, it doesn't degrade. But if you hold UV light on DNA for any extended period of time, UV light is going to begin to degrade DNA. So you can use this initially, but you just don't want to hold it anywhere where there might be some DNA, or you could end up degrading it. And again, those safety issues, you just want to be wary of the UV light and wear your protective equipment. So it also works for other things. You can find shoe prints, trace evidence, fluid detection, bite marks, bruises, explosive residue, and luminol enhancement can all be used with the Ruvus. Again, we're latent print examiners, so I can tell you how to use it with latent prints. Other ERT members could probably tell you how to use it to find some of these other things. So where do we use this? In our processing scheme, again, we use it right after a visual exam. You can look at it and be able to find things that haven't been super glued yet. Or we also use it right after super glue fuming to enhance super glue prints. And also, as I stated earlier, if you left a print on this white board and then super glued it, you've got white super glue on a white board, it's not going to be very easy to see. Just shining that Ruvus on there, and you a lot of times you'll be able to see those prints clear as day. So it's a good way to visualize prints that might be on a surface that you wouldn't be able to see the super glue on with just a visual exam. Photography, you can just hook the camera right up to the Ruvus system and then take a picture. Just like with super glue, you guys are going to notice the prints you see with the Ruvus system are going to be what we call reverse color, where it's the white or light residue on a dark background as opposed to a fingerprint card where you have the dark ridges on a black background. The Ruvus systems we have are basically like a light green prints with a dark green background, similar to the lovely color scheme we have in here. But that's basically what it looks like, is you'll have a very light green prints in a dark green background when you look through there. And that's easily corrected through photography, just reverse the negative, and then we get the black ridges that we like to compare. So here's an example of how the Ruvus can work. This is just a good old-fashioned Top Ramen soup wrapper. And there's a print right here, and you can see it's spanning two different colors. There's a lot of writing involved in here, and a white area here. So with just regular light, it's not going to be that easy to see. This is with just regular shining a light on it. You can get the part in the darker area. If you remember, that was the orange area. Just by getting some light on it, you can see that all right. But again, this part on the white the super white superglue on that white area is hard to see. So when we put the Rubus on it, you can see the difference. It takes out all this lettering is totally gone, and all you're left with is this nice print here, and spanning those two different colors. So where before you only had this top half, now you have the entire rest of the print on the other color. So you can't see the two different colors, you can't see the writing, the barcode is gone. You can see the numbers here barely are right in here, so you can see that's the same thing. Actually, this is up here. But you can see what the Rubus does by just taking away everything else and just leaving the print behind. So here's a greeting card, again, regular light, and with the Rubus, takes away all these lines that were in the way before, and you're left with just a nice print. It works well for what we call patent prints, or prints that are left in kind of a three-dimensional surface, like putty. It works well for bringing those out. Photographs, it works very well on. You can see how all you can see is just the print residue that's left behind. In the photograph, you've got a lot of different colors and backgrounds. And when you shine that Rubus on there and look through there, everything except the print is taken out. Shipping boxes, again, this would be kind of like a cereal box kind of consistency, where it's that kind of semi-porous, sort of glossy type box. Again, if it's like a true cardboard box, it's probably not going to work because it's not going to reflect off of there. But it works very well on boxes like cereal boxes, where it's got kind of that coating on there that gives it a little bit of reflectiveness. When you guys are doing the truck, you'll probably be a good 15 feet away. And what the Rubus, because when you're looking through that, it's blocking out every light except that UV light, so it's very hard to see where you're looking at when you're looking through there. There's actually a little laser, just like this, on the side of it. So when you see, oh, I see a print right there, you press the little laser on the side of it, and it'll point to exactly where you're looking, so that then your partner can go up there and mark the print so it can be photographed or developed later.
Okay, we're going to show you how to superglue a vehicle in a short amount of time, get latents. You don't have to get these little Loctite superglue packages, throw it in there, wait 2 to 3 hours. You can do it like 5 to 10 minutes. You can do a superglue a car. Okay, I've been with the Layton section for 11 years. The first 9, I was with Sieges, so 20 years in February with the FBI. All right? But we're going to do the superglue of a vehicle to show you how you can do it with less than 10 minutes. All right? First thing you do, you want to inspect for all visible prints. Everything, look for everything. You're going to document it. Make sure you document it. This is the most important thing, because you may need to keep these notes. They may have to go into court with you. And the main thing you're going to hear all day is a photograph of all visible print. All day long you're going to hear that. That's the main thing. Photograph all visible prints. Even if you think it's not a good print, photograph it. That's our job, to say it's good or not. That's not your job, okay? You need a drop cloth. We have cloths over here. This is not the norm. Normally you have like a large plastic bag that's clear, so you can see the prints develop, but this is just demonstrative purposes today. But you want it large enough to fit around the entire vehicle, at least 3 feet around the entire vehicle. What you're gonna do, you're gonna get a test strip, and you can use anything, a piece of plastic, put some tape on it, and you're gonna tape the side mirrors on the car, okay? Because we're doing the exterior. You're going to do the side mirrors on the car, both sides. You're going to tape a test strip, put a print on it, tape it to the mirror. This is your test print, so you can see that the superglue is working on that vehicle. Excuse me. Those heaters you use outside for those little chambers, you're going to have 2 of them. You're going to place them on opposite sides of the vehicle. One at the driver's side tire, and the other at the passenger side, the back tire, okay? And of course, you're gonna set them both on high, because we use high heat in a short amount of time for superglue. All right, you're gonna review everything, make sure you get everything in place, because you're gonna need at least 2 people to do this. Just make sure you can see these prints. And do not let the plastic touch the heater because it's going to burn a hole in it. All right, if you need someone to stand on it, you know they're going to stand on it because you don't want to touch that heater. It's going to burn a hole in that plastic. Okay, at the same time, you and your partner are going to place the glue in the heater. Understanding that glue is flammable. You know, back at the lab a couple years ago, guy was processing some cartridges, had a hole in the tray. Those little aluminum trays used outside, it was a hole in it, seeped out, got on the heater, flame in the chamber. Cartridges flying off and everything, pop, 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 pop. So my supervisor like, go see what's that. I said, I'm not going in there. He said, no, you're not gonna get hit, it doesn't matter, you know, it's just popping. I said, well, I don't wanna find out. I'll be the first guy to get shot like that. So he went in there. Okay, but make sure you don't get any glue on the heater. We're going to glue the vehicle for a minute and a half. The whole time you're inspecting the vehicle. Then after that minute and a half to 2 minutes, you're going to reverse position of those heaters. Okay, the one that was behind the front tire, you're going to place it in front of the rear tire on the driver's side. And the one that was in front of the rear tire on the passenger side, you're going to place that behind the front tire on the passenger side. All right. Then at the same time, when your partner's ready, you can do the same thing. You're gonna put the glue and you're gonna place it on the heater. You want it about 3 to 5 inches from that tire. And you want it just right below this baseboard because you want those fumes to come up and over. All right, now he's positioning it to the back of the front tire. All right, now that's the outside. Now, less than 6 minutes, you've done the outside of the vehicle. Okay, now we want to get into the inside of the vehicle. You can do the same thing with the test strip. Before you put the test strip in, I want you to visibly just inspect the entire interior of the car for prints. And what do you do when you see a visible print? You photograph it. All right, and even for the outside, you may use a good light source and magnifying glass to inspect because it's good to look at these prints with oblique lighting, okay? Flashlight works good. All right. Okay, this is what you're going to concentrate on. You're going to concentrate on all the door handles, the mirrors, the buckles, everything. But you're going to hang the test strip from the rear view mirror, all right? Small car, you're gonna place the heater in the front seat between the driver's side and the passenger side. Just one heater. If it's a large car, you may use two heaters. Put a brick in the back of the car, put the heater on the brick for a large car. Now, Eric showed you the Superglue presentation where we have heat and humidity applied to our chambers. We have humidity applied to these chambers. But for Superglue, you don't really need that. But if you want to add humidity, that is not a problem. Okay, you want to place a pot of hot water in the car and process it, then that's fine too. But it has shown to be used and works fine without humidity applied. Now we did a class in Chicago and a lot of the police officers said they put a pot of water in the van, put super glue in it, and they had prints everywhere. So I'm not gonna say don't do that. Whatever works for you when you get results, it's all that matters. All right. You want to close all doors and windows if possible. Now right here it says leave a small crack in the window. You can actually just put it through the door and close the door. The door closed. So don't worry about sealing a small crack with tape because not that much fume is going to come out of that window or out of the side of that door because you can close the door of the car. And we're going to show you, like I say, in the afternoon. Once the fumes are present, you're going to do it for between 60 to 90 seconds. You may want to open the car doors to flap them a little bit to get those fumes circulating inside that vehicle. And you're going to look at that visible print to make sure that those prints are developing. All right? And again, the main thing, It says all latent prints. It doesn't say all good latent prints. All latent prints you're going to photograph. And just like anything else, you can just throw it in trash. It's super glue. It's the same thing. As far as the other, just using the chambers outside, the same thing as super glue, where you dispose of it. Any questions on doing the interior and exterior of a car? All right, I'm going to show you real quick how you can make a super glue chamber with a plastic bag and some aluminum foil. Just real quick. You got small items, you put them in a plastic bag, all right? Something real quick. You want to place the item in there so the bag won't actually touch the items of evidence. You take some super glue, fold the aluminum foil, all right? I'm going to put super glue on this side. And you're going to fold it together, all right? Then you're going to roll it out. You can use anything. Roll it out. Get a little friction started for that heat. For that super glue, then you're going to open it up. As long as it's not sticking together. You're going to place it in the bag. And you're going to close it. Then you're going to add humidity to the bag. Don't breathe in. I'm going to put this outside so after lunch you can see the prints develop. All right? And that's a quick super glue chamber.
Okay. We are going to talk about some post-mortem fingerprinting techniques. I don't know how often you all will have to use them, but they are very good to have in case you do have to use them. We are on a constant rotation to Dover, especially Dover Air Force Base, and I was just there last week, I believe. We do week-long rotations. So when you go to Dover, you have no idea what condition the bodies are going to be in. A lot of them have been hit by IEDs. The new thing is the SVB IED, which those are the suicide vehicle-borne IEDs. So a lot of times, you don't have a whole lot to work with. A lot of times, the only portion of the body that contains any skin is the palmar surface. And that's because they tend to clench their fists when they're in explosions and things. And sometimes we can pry their fingers open and then there is skin so that we can get prints. So these are some different techniques that we do utilize in order to do post-mortem printing. Okay, so there's a lot of different equipment that you need. It obviously depends on the condition of the body and the location that you're in. The ink and the inking plates, we like for you to see this, to see that this has been done, but it's more of a method of the past. Now we use powder and we use the handy print, which we're going to get into that a little bit. The ink tends to be messy and it doesn't work as well if the body is wet. And that's something that a lot of the conditions that we see, the body is wet. So you have to dry that off, and powder works a little bit better than ink in those instances. Okay, spoons, spatulas, tissue builder is something that we do use a lot if the fingers are very wrinkled. And here's our little slide to show the spoons. Have you guys seen these spoons before? They work if rigor has set in so that you don't have to actually roll the finger, it rolls it for you. Okay, different identification techniques. You're going to determine the appropriate method based on the condition of the body. And because of this, you need to look at each finger individually. Okay, so you want to print the individual, and the first thing you do is look at the thumb. Well, the thumb has been blown off, so you're not going to be using that one. So then you look at the index finger, and oh, it's okay, but there's a rip down the center. So then you go on to the middle finger. Oh, all the skin is intact. So it's always determined by the condition of the body, each finger independently. So you want to clean the friction ridges. You want to get all the dirt out of there. There's no fancy technique that you have to use. The thing that works best is a toothbrush. Get in those ridges and clean just like you would. Obviously not a toothbrush you're going to be using later. A toothbrush that you're going to be able to dispose of properly. So we're going to show you here how to clean the fingers. So here's a body that's already beginning to decompose. This might be a body from Katrina. So you want to prepare the finger by cleaning it and do an examination of that skin. You want to see, do you have the epidermal skin there or do you have the dermal layer? We can also make identifications from the dermal or the second layer of skin if necessary. We don't like to do it, it's a lot more difficult. So we want to try to print a finger that does have the outer surface of the skin available. We also need to dry the finger, and that's actually what's happening here. No, they're not catching the finger on fire. A lighter or a light bulb, or you can even use a heat gun or something in order to dry that finger. The drier, the better. A wet finger is not going to print very well. Something else we have to do in some instances, not always pleasant, is we have to cut the fingers off in order to be able to print them. Sometimes due to the stiffness of the body, you're not able to get a decent print unless the finger is removed. And I would say the only time we cut the fingers off is when they're really charred and burned. And I usually, if I'm cutting the fingers off, it's because there's only skin on the palmar surface. And I cut it off so that I can actually cut that skin off, and then I usually put it on my finger and roll it, obviously with gloves on. Okay, so this is just showing you after they cut the finger off, or they didn't have to in this instance, just take a scalpel and cut around the edge. Try to get that first digit of the finger if possible. That is called the gloving method, and as I previously stated, you just take the skin, you cut it off of the finger, and then you put it on your own finger and you roll it. And you usually get a fairly good print that way. It's a lot better than if you try to print it on the individual. This is an example of what we call degloving, and I had an individual at Dover. Well, first of all, the individual came through and he didn't have any arms. They had been blown off. Then I got a hand that came through, and fortunately it belonged to him, but that hand apparently had been soaking in water. And when I got it, the skin just peeled off. So this is what happens if it's obviously been soaking in water for quite some time. The skin just peeled right away from the body. And that's what it looks like underneath. They actually just cut the first joint, the skin off, and that's what the hand looks like underneath. Pretty neat. It looks like they're wearing a glove, but that's the outer layer of the skin. This is an older method that was used. I'm just going to go through these quickly. That is when you actually cut the skin off and roll it on an inking plate. As I said, we usually use powder versus ink. Just go through these. That is a footprint that was actually printed to identify the individual. Now, footprints work the same as fingerprints and palm prints. Unfortunately, we don't usually have footprints on file. One instance where footprints do work well is for pilots, if there was a plane crash, because usually pilots' prints aren't on file, because the footprint will be preserved because it's in the boot versus a hand. There you can see what it looks like. Here's more of the inking on a very wet hand. These are some older techniques that were used. Now that's the spoon method, and you just put a strip of the fingerprint card in the spoon. So if you're unable to bend and roll the finger, you just place the spoon around the finger and set the finger down in it. And that's what the prints look like. Obviously they're not very pretty, but they look like they would be identifiable. I'd have to look at those a little bit longer. Okay, so your identification technique is going to depend on the condition of the body. We've already discussed that. So hard, wrinkled skin. One thing that we do when we get hands or fingers into the laboratory, what we usually do, or if they're hard and brittle, is we soak them in, it's kind of like fabric softener, if you want to think of it like that, because it will actually make the skin a lot more pliable. so that we're able to print it. So we have a 50-50 a restorative for the skin and a Metaflow solution that we use. Inject tissue builder, that will remove the wrinkles. And the tissue builder, you just put in a syringe and you actually put it below the first joint and it'll plump that finger right up. So if you have a finger that is extremely wrinkled, difficult to print, inject a little bit of that tissue builder, it's really easy to do, then you get a nice surface area to print. Duck seal method. Duck seal is just putty that you can actually go to Home Depot or Lowe's and buy. It works very well if you need to get into the contours of the finger, if a hand has been wet, or if it's very dry and brittle, because it allows you to push into get the ridges and the furrows without being on a completely flat, hard surface. Microseal method, we're gonna talk about a little bit later. We use Accutrans or the extrude now versus the Microseal, only because it's mixed already for you, so you don't have to worry about getting the wrong concentration of the Microseal for it to be too hard or too soft. You don't want that to happen. Handy print is our most preferred method today. It's very simple to use. I'm just going through these briefly because we're gonna do a practical with them later, so you guys will get to work with everything. Osmotic rehydration is our very fancy term for boiling. Boiling fingers works very well also. So we like to say osmotic rehydration, but it's boiling the fingers. If it's a water-soaked specimen, and as you can see, that hand has obviously been soaking in water, you want to dry it thoroughly, you want to clean it, and to toughen the skin, we can use acetone or formalin, whatever you have available to you. Alcohol is very effective in drying the skin. Usually if I have hands that have been wet, I just take a piece of cotton or a paper towel and I hold the alcohol, just regular rubbing alcohol on the fingers, and that will usually dry it up enough for me to get a viable print. Handy print. This is our handy print. This is our new favorite technique. We're also teaching it to the new agents going through training. We're just starting with the new classes coming in now to take major case prints using handy print. And handy print is very simple to use. It's just a slightly adhesive surface, and you can just stick the hand or the finger onto the handy print. You use powder versus ink, and it's pretty simple technique. These are just major case prints that we took with handy print. I wanted to pass them around so you guys can get an idea of what that looks like. You're all going to be, you'll have partners later when you go through the postmortem rotation, printing each other and seeing how the handy print works. It is multi-purpose. It can be used on living or deceased individuals, and it also can be used for tire print and shoe print comparisons. So it's not specific to fingerprints. Okay, so here we have some slides kind of going through the process. Cleaning and drying the fingers. And then all you need to do is just take either a camel hair brush or whatever brush you have available, and you don't need a lot of powder. It's just like if you're inking someone, you don't need a lot of ink. So just apply a thin coat of powder. And then you are going to, you can either buy them in squares or you can buy them in the 8x8 sheets and just cut them so that they'll fit the fingers. And you just place the handy print, as you can see here, just place it on the finger. Now you don't need to place it on there and roll, because all you're going to do is make a double impression. It will stick to the finger where it needs to be. And that's what the print looks like. So pretty good quality print for a deceased individual, I think. And it is in correct color and it is in correct position. So it makes it easier on the photographers because they don't have to go back and reverse anything later. And then what we do when we go to Dover, and you would do this if you go out to a scene and you're processing a deceased individual, you can just take a fingerprint card and you can photocopy it on a transparency. So you have a photocopy, it's a transparent fingerprint card. And then you just stick the handy print on the back of the card and then you can label it. So we would know what finger it originated from. And there you're able to see it. you're out at a scene, you don't have to have a transparency with a fingerprint card on it. You can just use a clear sheet and stick it to the back of that. As long as you label it appropriately, that's all that we would need. You want to put any necessary notations on it. Of course, you wouldn't be IDing it, but you could say it's the number 2 finger, initial it, and put the date that the print was taken. Okay, this is the duck seal method. I want to go through this very briefly because this is something that we used to use before. The handy print is much easier than actually using the duck seal. This is when, we'll go on a little further, you use a rubber glove and you use a Q-tip or cotton and you apply ink to the finger. And then you cut out a section of a rubber glove and you ink the finger, place the finger down in the rubber glove, place it down in the duck seal, apply pressure. You can see it a little better on that slide. And then you're actually doing a lift from the finger, just like you would do powdering and lifting out in the field. So you just lift the impression off using tape. So it's just a few more steps. And then you just want to put backing like you would do with a lift card, which we're going to do powdering and lifting later today, if you guys haven't done that yet. And then you just cut it out and you mount it on a fingerprint card. It's several steps. It's another one of those things that was done in the past. We just like to show it so you can see that it's a possibility, but the handy print is going to work probably better and be a lot easier to accomplish. Microseal. Microseal is another casting agent that has been used. Who has used Microseal in here?
Yesterday.
You did it yesterday. Okay, so you guys are familiar with Microseal. We prefer Accutrans over Microseal these days because it doesn't have to be mixed. So I know that a lot of people probably have used Microseal in the field. Here's an example of just mixing it, the casting agent with the hardener. And all you need to do is mix it up, coat the finger with the Microseal, allow it to dry 3 to 4 minutes, depending on the temperature, and then just peel it off in one solid motion. Here are some examples of someone using the Microseal. They Microsealed the entire palm. Now, Microseal and Accutrans is not something that you would want to use on a regular basis on living individuals, but I was talking to Wes earlier, and he was saying that he had an individual whose hands were in such poor condition that he couldn't get a good print. So sometimes having a casting agent and something that's actually going to mold around those fingers versus having to roll them and print them is going to be your best option. So if you have the Accutrans, I would use it for that, but normally I would either use handy print or the regular inking method in order to print living individuals. Microseal impressions when you're printing an individual will be in correct color, a correct position, and you would want to powder them before you put the Microseal or the Accutrans on the individual. Okay. Accutrans, we've been talking about, is the newer method. It's a very effective casting method. It's made of polyvinyl siloxane. I don't know why I put that in there. I guess I just like to say it for some reason. You don't need to remember what it's made out of. It is available in multiple colors. We have the transparent, right? The transparent here today. It also comes in white and brown that we've used. So if you are using it not only for post-mortem, but if you're using it when you're out powdering and lifting, the color of the Accutrans is going to be dependent on the color of your surface. No mixing is required. It comes out the little tube at the end and it's already mixed for you. And then there's no excess waste because you can just pop off the tip, throw it away, and cover it back up, and everything in the tube will stay good for a while. Here's a little demo with the Accutrans. Pretend this is a deceased individual. You just need to powder the finger. You always want to powder the finger first because that ensures correct color, because the powder will be on the furrows, or the ridges, excuse me, instead of the furrows. You want to apply the Accutrans and use something so that you have a thin, even coating. It's going to look like that. You want to allow it to dry. Peel it off in one solid motion. And that's your print in the end. That was my finger, so. I hope it didn't look like a deceased individual. So impressive, does a good job, right? Okay. Okay, it sets at about 4 minutes if it's around 70 degrees, and if it's colder out, it takes longer to set. So just be aware of your surroundings and make sure that you leave it on long enough so that you don't try to peel it off, and you guys will see when we do this later. A lot of people get really anxious, they peel it off, and you have half of it still coating the ridges, and then you don't get an acceptable print. You always want to powder the finger first, so that ensures that it is in the correct color. You don't want to over-powder because you're going to get powder in the furrows, and also you don't need to over-powder at any time. It's just like over-inking, you just kind of make a mess, and it doesn't do any good for anyone. Osmotic rehydration, that is boiling of the fingers. It is something that we used a lot. I didn't personally go over to the tsunami in Phuket, but there were a lot of other latent examiners from around the world working over there. And it was kind of cool because nobody knew about the boiling method except our guys. So we kind of got to introduce that to the world, and they were able to get a lot more prints that were usable than when they were not using the boiling method. So it's nice to be able to do that. Now, when you are boiling the fingers, it doesn't take very long. You're going to have to cut the finger, or if you can get a pot of boiling water over to the body, then you can just dip the body down in there. It only takes 7 to 10 seconds. What I like to do is dip the finger in there, give it a few seconds, take it out and look at it. You can tell if the ridges have plumped up or not. If they haven't, dip it back in there for a few more seconds. This is an example of a body in a pretty bad condition. The reason we're showing this is because sometimes when you're trying to print a body, you have to find the hands because they're not attached, or I should say the skin is not attached to where the hands should be. The hand is, can you guys see it? See that nail? The hand is floating down in that water. The next one you can see it a little bit better. There's the hand. So obviously degloving has occurred and it's just hanging out beside the body. Okay, this is a perfect instance where we would want to use osmotic rehydration. The hand is very dry, very brittle, and the ridges are, you can see, you really can't even see any ridge detail. They just dip the entire palm of the hand down into the pot, let it soak for a few seconds, remove the hand, and that's the same hand afterwards, so you can see the difference. Then you powder it, and you use the handy print, like we already talked about. And sorry, I apologize, that's a little blurry, but that's the print they were able to get from that. So when you saw the hand initially, you probably thought no one would ever be able to print that, so much improved. Before and after, pretty big difference, yes? Before and after. Here's the important part. Before, after. So we go from a print that is not identifiable, you can barely even see anything there, to a print that's beautiful. That's what I like to see in my cases. Okay, so burned or charred specimens are something else that we need to deal with, and you need to be careful because I know I said you need to clean off the fingers with a toothbrush or something, but sometimes they're so dry and brittle that you will actually flake away any skin that is there. So you really have to take note of the condition of the skin and make sure that you're very careful with that. Clenching of the hands may preserve the ridge detail. We already discussed that. I've had several people now at Dover where I was able to open the skin and maybe they only had skin left on one or two fingers, but that allowed them to be identified. So not fun to do, but it's nice to get a good result in the end. Rigor mortis, sometimes you have to cut the fingers to cut the joint in order to loosen that up. There's also some techniques when they've stiffened up that you can just bend the hands at certain joints in order to loosen those up. breaking the finger. You don't always want to break the finger because it can actually destroy the ridge detail if it breaks in the wrong location. Okay, stages of decomposition vary. One thing we have to do sometimes is ID from the second layer or the dermal layer of the skin. And where you see one friction ridge on the epidermis, it appears as two ridges in the dermis. And that's what it looks like. So that is the same print. We have the epidermal layer, which looks like a normal fingerprint that you guys would see. And this is the dermal layer. So for every ridge, you have a train track effect going on.
Powder and lifting. I know you guys are all great at this. If it works for you the way you're doing it, keep doing it the way you're doing it. All right? The main thing, using powder, always applied to a non-porous surface, you know. Now, it's possible, but, you know, you're not going to do this. If you want to show, like, your kids something, you can actually use magnetic powder on paper, and it'll develop a print. But you didn't hear that, because you're going to send all the paper items into us. So you didn't hear that. All right? And you're going to use it to make the prints visible. That's why you're doing it. You got a white print on this surface and super glue, you're going to apply black powder so you can make that visible. As Eric stated earlier, the moisture, the powder clings to the moisture in the print. So, and it dates back to 1900s. So we've been using this for a while, especially black powder. You know, you go a lot of these police departments, that's all they use is black powder. Even on black surfaces, they use black powder. They don't have a lot of money. So that shouldn't be a problem for you guys. You have enough money. All right, this is the main thing you need to understand. It's not caustic or toxic. It's good. You're all right. I mean, you don't have to just breathe it in. You don't want to do that. All right? All right. Applied after super glue or the dye stain process. That's it. You know, unless you can move it, you're going to powder it. Normally you send it to us, but if you can move it, you send it to us after you super glue it, right? Okay. Doesn't work on wet or sticky surfaces too well. So, and you can try it when we go through this building, you guys are going to trash it up. You see something like kind of sticky or tacky or wet, try some powder on it, but you may mess your brush up, so you may not want to try it. But the main thing, before you do anything, not just powder, anything, you're going to visually examine it. And as Eric said earlier, once you put powder on it, we can't do any more latent prints on it, so it's done. We use white, gray, black, and the metallic, the magnetic powder. Now, we don't recommend fluorescent powders in now section because it's harder to photograph, but if it works for you, that's fine. As an agent in Chicago, he loves it. It works for him. I'm not mad, you know. It's not recommended by the lab. These are the ingredients in the powder. All right, what you need to understand is the magnetic isn't the powder. The wand is magnetized. The powder is metal and powder mixed together. All right, so the powder isn't magnetic. It's the magnetized wand. These are other powders that you can use. As I stated, it's not recommended. Just something cute right here. Fluorescent powder, but what's that spelled backwards?
Powder.
Oh, that's cute. But again, fluorescent powders, difficult to photograph. All right, this is your fiberglass brush right here. This will be your best friend in the field. All right, Alan. Can you give me a camel hairbrush? I didn't see any. All right, this came up before. Camel hairbrushes. We call them cleanup brushes. You're not going to use them to powder anything. You're going to use your fiberglass brush. All right? The camel hair brush is used after you powder with the fiberglass. You want to clean up the powder in the furrows, in between the ridges. You want to clean it up by using the camel hair brush. So you're not going to use the camel hair brush to process. Okay, this is the camel hair brush. Once the print is developed, then you want to clean it up. You're not going to use it to process, just to clean up the latent print that you develop with the fiberglass brush, all right? Cleanup brush. All right. Again, bear with us. Now we have a large wad of cotton. But you can hold it just like this, and you can process large areas with cotton. So it saves you time, as opposed to you using a brush that's like for a car. You can use cotton. Lightly put powder in the cotton and lightly dust the area, and you can develop a print. Saves you a lot of time on a car. But try to get a big wad of it, don't get cotton balls. But it's gonna work. It's gonna work. And again, it's just like the camel hair brush, it's used to clean up latents too. You know, lightly dust the latent. Well, one thing to mention, when you have these brushes, you got the powder. You don't want to dip into the jar with the brush. You want to place it in the top or piece of paper and go there, because once you take it from the jar, process something, you're taking this dirt right here, putting it back in here. You're going to destroy that powder. So separate your powder. All right. And then this is the tricky part, but it's not really tricky at all. Contrast with the surface. Black powder on a white backing, and the opposite, white or gray on a dark surface. So I know, I've seen it before. People got powder in it. I don't see the print. You got white powder on white backing. That's why you don't see the print. Okay, the tricky one here is right here. White or gray on reflective surfaces. Now you would think black, right? But if you're using it and you have a flash, once you flash that black powder, it's going to come back, the ridge is going to be white. So we use white or gray powder on reflective surfaces, because when you flash, it's black ridges. And when we compare, we use black ridges. From the fingerprint card, you got black ridges, and on a photograph, it's black ridges. That's what we use to compare. All right, I went over this. Just remember to dip the tips. And you don't have to squish it all in there either. You don't have to just push it in there. Once you separate it, just touch it, lightly touch it. Once the latent becomes visible, you want to brush along the lines of that latent print. Now you see the pattern types, the loops, the arch, and the whorls. Once you see that ridge form, you want to brush along those ridges. If it's a whorl, you want to brush in a circular motion. If it's a loop, in and out. Arch, up in the middle, and out the other end. That's how you want to brush. But continuous brushing, you can destroy it, because the latent print is very fragile, and any type of friction can destroy it. All right? Even with this magnetic powder, once you take the magnetic powder, make sure that only the powder touches the surface. Once that tip of that magnetized wand touches it, it can destroy that latent print. All right, you want to make sure the powder is the only thing that touches that latent print. All right. Let's do it this way. Let's just say I have powder on this paper. I poured it out onto the paper. I'm going to lightly brush the surface. Barely touching it, just lightly brush the surface. Once I see those ridge formations, I'll try to go in the direction of the ridge flow. You don't have to mash it down in print. I've seen people go like this, you know. It's just a waste of energy. Just lightly brush. You know, you all like this. Is that, that's pretty though, isn't it? You're just wasting energy. Just lightly brush. You develop prints. Just hold aside. Because you're going to get dirty. And you got your brush. Okay, I use this for black powder. That's going to always use your black powder. Don't switch colors. That's your black powder brush. This is your white powder brush. It's like that. Don't switch them up. Once you see a print start to develop, if you want to add more moisture to it, you can do that. You can blow, add some humidity to the print, and add more powder to it. This is what I said earlier. You're going to clean it with the hammerhead brush, the excess powder that's in the ridges. All right, right here, we have a light box. So we have a plastic bag with black powder. We got a light box. We can easily see the latent. That's all at stake at the bottom. Excuse me. And as I stated earlier, lightly wipe over the surface. Lightly. Because if you come down too hard, you can destroy that latent. So you want to lightly brush with that cotton. All right, let's see the magnetic wand. Magnetic powder. Wait a bit, watch this. I'm going to do it again.
Not twice.
Where did it come from? All right. All right. Now you want to lightly just have the powder touch the surface. And one thing about the magnetic powder, once you see that print develop, since it lightly touches the surface, you can dispose of it. But then to clean up, just lightly go over it, and it'll clean it up. Making sure that the wand does not touch the surface, that's it. That's the main thing. Friction is the enemy of the latent print. The enemy. Okay, we did this. You disengage to release the powder. You can pass the wand over the surface. I went all over that. Okay, now we get into lifts. Now, can I get my powder print? Okay, I'm sorry. Thank you. All right. What is a lift? That's how you preserve a latent print. You lift it, or you photograph it. That's how you preserve it. You want to remove enough of the powder without destroying it. Now, that's why I use super glue, so you can lift again. Super glue a print, try to lift it. It's not that good. Add some more powder, you can lift it again. That's a good thing about a super glue print. But this is the main thing. The function is to preserve the crime scene print, just like a photograph. You're preserving it. It can be used in courts as an exhibit. And we can scan it in. And you also, we make photographs. The lifts that you guys send to us, we make photographs of it. Send you the lift back. We got our photographs now. Because we compare photographs with the known impressions. We don't use the lifts. All right. Take one end of the tape. Fold it. Take the other end and fold it. Make like a horseshoe shape with it, and you want to lay it down on the latent. Take in your knuckle, get all the bubbles out. Here, give me another white backing card, please. Take all the bubbles out. If you so happen to get bubbles in it, don't worry about it. It's good enough that we can do a comparison. Thank you, sir. You want to lift it up? And you're going to place it down the same way you picked it up, if you can get it right. If you can get it right. You can take your knuckle and rub out all the creases. So, just say it was on this table, you went from the table to the card, and that's your lift. Making sure when you fold those both ends of that tape, and you send that lift in, if your prints are on that bottom of the tape, just put an X through it. We normally figure it as your guys that you is your fingerprints, but we want to be sure, so you guys just put an X through it, you know, just to help us out. You can also use a roller. If you don't think you're that skillful where you can't lift it. I'm trying to see a good area. Let's just say right here. If you got a print right here, you folded both ends. The print is here. You're going to take that roller and roll it over that print. All right. Then you're going to grab your backing card, place it up under there, and roll it down. And you transfer it that way. No bubbles, all right? In your case, you have hinge lifters. It's basically, it's little pieces of tape, the sticky side. This is the cover right here. Once you take this printed page off and you lift the print, you have a cover for it. Now it's either transparent, black, or white. Four times. Okay, this is the black backing. You're gonna use white or gray powder for this one. Same thing. All right. Okay, rubberless. Before we get into rubberless, I'm gonna show you something. You got three prints. I'm Russian, so don't go by my skills as an artist. You got three prints that you want to lift, but you can tell. Okay, thank you. You can tell this print is bad and that print is bad. So you're just going to lift the middle print, right? No, you're going to lift all of them. You're going to lift all of them because it shows us orientation of the fingerprints. So we know it's like that. We know it's the middle finger. I'm not giving anybody the finger. I'm just saying it's the middle finger. But we know it's either 3 or 8. So it helps us search. So don't worry about how it looks. You know, let us worry about that. If you think it's bad, don't worry about that. Let us worry about it being bad. Lift all of them. So it helps us with the orientation of the print. All right, let's get in the rubber list. Okay, you have white backing and you have black backing. But the only problem with the black backing is that they will be in reverse position and reverse color. But white backing is just reverse position. All right. Good thing about these, you have a cover. Oh, I'm sorry. You have a cover and you have the white. This is sticky. This is, but not as sticky as transparent tape. But it works good on curved surfaces. And you use it the same way, but you can just lay it flat, lift it up, and you want to preserve it, you're going to cover it up. If it helps, take some scissors. Before you lift that print, cut this in so you know exactly where the coverage is going to go. All right? If it helps you. All right, you have gel lifts. They're just like the rubber lifts. All right, I know you guys have used them before, so, you know, most of you guys. It's used the same as rubber lifts. It's used the same. But you've been used a lot for dust prints, especially after you photograph, because you're going to photograph first before you do anything. Because if you lift the print first and destroy it, it's gone. You can't get it back, so you have to photograph it first. That's why they keep saying photograph it, photograph it. All right, you use Accutrans. And MK has examples of Accutrans on some stuff. Okay, this is a lift off a wood cabinet. Now, this is the hinge lifter and the Accutrans that we use, so you can see the difference. This is a painted door frame. Tried the hinge lifter and did the Accutrans. So you can check it out and see the difference. And this is off of, this is actually a transparent lift off of a, what's it called? The inside of the car, the leather surface. It's like the leather surface, and you can see the cracks in it, and you can see the Accutrans print. So Accutrans gets in, it gets in the textured surface really well, and you get a good print. So if you have a textured surface, the Accutrans works really well with it. All right. And another thing to think about, it's going to be in reverse color if you do it before you put powder on it. So make sure you put powder on it first before you put the Accutrans down, just like you did on your fingers. Here's an example. It's working. Get out of here. You're supposed to say, ooh. Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. And your day is done. All right, hinge lifter. Accutrans. You see more detail in Accutrans. Because the Accutrans got in the textured surface really well. Three things to have on your lifts: source, initials, and date. Your initials, the date, and where you got it. You can add some drawing to it. You have backing room for you to add little artistry work for you guys. It helps. So you know location. Source, initials, and date. Which helps when you're on the stand and they say, where do you get this lift? You can look at your lift and say, okay, it was taken here on this date by me. And you have everything. And you can tell where because you drew a description of it. Did everyone get that? Okay, we'll do that. Sketches don't have to be detailed, but it helps. You want as much help as possible, because this may be years later. So you want all the information there to help you out if you understand, saying where you get to live from. And you can be like, well, I don't remember. So you look at it and you're like, okay, now I know. But if you didn't put anything down, you're going to be like, I mean, I took it, but I don't remember where. So put as much information on here to protect you so you don't look crazy up on the stand. Okay, this is good too. If you have those thin, porous gloves, after a while, if they're tight, they can actually leave a print with the glove on. So it's good to know that even though they said somebody had gloves on, it's still possible they left a fingerprint. It's still possible.